Three.
Hi, I'm Mariella Frostrup. Welcome to Story to Action, a webinar devised by film and content creators and producers for their peers within the creative industries. You don't need me to tell you that COVID-19 has become the focus of our daily lives. It's also been a focused shock to our social systems and will certainly result in a changed world. But how can we ensure those changes are positive ones, addressing future global challenges, and particularly climate change? And how can we best use this time of lockdown to influence the rebuilding and renewal that will need to follow? It's imperative that we take this painful chapter, positive lessons in how to improve our world, not just revert to our unsustainable past. The aim of this event is to encourage all you creatives out there to use your skills to find and tell stories in shape and influence the narrative of a post-coronavirus world, whether through a 10-second meme, a 5-minute short film, or documentary or drama to fully explore a topic. And to help inspire you today, we have three fantastic participants in this conversation. James Thornton, the Chief Executive and Founder of Client Earth, Europe's pioneering environmental law charity, who is named by the New Statesman as one of 10 people who can change the world. Jerry Rothwell, the extraordinary filmmaker, whose award-winning 2015 film, How to Change the World, tells the story of the founders of Greenpeace, and Jaime Winstone, a passionate advocate for environmental issues, campaigner for Extinction Rebellion, and a brilliant actress to boot. But before I talk to them, let's take a quick look at a film which almost predates Greta Thunberg, before she was born, in fact, inspired people to challenge corporations and governments. It's, of course, 2007's An Inconvenient Truth about Al Gore's campaign to educate people on global warming. Let's take a look at a clip now.
The scientific consensus is that we are causing global warming. I am Al Gore. I used to be the next president of the United States of America. This is Patagonia, 75 years ago, and the same glacier today. This is Mount Kilimanjaro, 30 years ago, and last year, within the decade. There will be no more snows of Kilimanjaro.
This is really not a political issue so much as a moral issue. Temperature increases are taking place all over the world,
and that's causing stronger storms.
This is the biggest crisis in the history of this country.
Early this morning, Hurricane Katrina slammed into New Orleans.
Is it possible that we should prepare against other threats besides terrorists?
The film had a big impact, but soon after its release in 2007/8, the financial crisis unfolded, throwing economies into mass recession, much like today. And as a result, the narrative for environmental change was overtaken and mostly forgotten. Many people remained active, but as a global focal point, it vanished. However, in the last couple of years, there has been a rebuild, a resurgence of interest and activism, enhanced perhaps most particularly by the efforts of the phenomenal, young, passionate advocate, Greta Thunberg. Let's take a look at her in action.
This is not a drill. My name is Greta Thunberg. We are living in the beginning of a mass extinction. Our climate is breaking down. Children like me are giving up their education to protest. But we can still fix this. You can still fix this. To survive, we need to stop burning fossil fuels. But this alone will not be enough. Lots of solutions are talked about. But what about the solution that is right in front of us? I'll let my friend George explain.
There is a magic machine that sucks carbon out of the air, costs very little, and builds itself. It's called a tree. A tree is an example of a natural climate solution. Mangroves, peat bogs, jungles, marshes, seabeds, kelp forests, swamps, coral reefs, they take carbon out of the air and lock it away. Nature is a tool we can use to repair our broken climate. These natural climate solutions could make a massive difference.
Pretty cool, right?
But only if we also leave fossil fuels in the ground.
Here's the crazy part. Right now, we are ignoring them. We spend 1,000 times more on global fossil fuel subsidies than on natural-based solutions.
Natural climate solutions get just 2% of all the money used on tackling climate breakdown.
This is your money. It is your taxes and your savings.
Even more crazy, right now, when we need nature the most, we're destroying it faster than ever.
Up to 200 species are going extinct every single day.
Much of the Arctic ice is gone. Most of our wild animals have gone. Much of our soil has gone.
So what should we do?
What should you do?
It's simple. We need to protect, restore, and fund. Protect. Tropical forests are being cut down at the rate of 30 football pitches a minute.
Where nature is doing something vital, we must protect it.
Restore. Much of our planet has been damaged.
But nature can regenerate, and we can help ecosystems bounce back.
Fund.
We need to stop funding things that destroy nature and pay for things that help it.
It is that simple. Protect, restore, fund.
This can happen everywhere. Many people have already begun using natural climate solutions. We need to do it on a massive scale.
You can be part of this.
Vote for people who defend nature.
Share this video. Talk about this.
All around the world, there are amazing movements fighting for nature. Join them.
Everything counts. What you do counts.
And George Monbiot in polemical action there. And I wondered, well, first of all, just let me say to all of you out there that there is a chat bar to the right of your screen. And at any point during today's event, we'd love to welcome questions from you to our participants. So don't think I'm going to monopolize them. We'd really welcome your thoughts and ideas and questions too. If I could, I'm going to start with you, James. We just saw Greta Thunberg there, who, you know, has absolutely inspired millions of young people to become interested in activism and in the cause of climate change. I wondered what it was that had inspired the young James.
Love is the answer. So I fell in love with the natural world as a boy. And then I wanted to be a scientist and study the organisms, the ecosystems that I loved. And by the time I got to university, I realized that things were changing and that I could spend my whole time, my whole life studying things I loved and watch them go extinct. And I looked around and I wondered, what could I do to save it? And at that point, there really wasn't much by way of environmental law practice. But I thought, law is a really powerful thing. If I become a lawyer, I'll figure out what to do. And then I did that in the United States, and it was very successful with many others there. When I moved to the EU, I found that there weren't any lawyers in the environmental movement to speak of in the EU. And there was no group of lawyers serving the needs of the planet, people, and the environmental movement. So that's why I set up Client Earth. And we do two things. One, help write laws. So you go to parliaments and you help write laws. And that's important because you're writing the rules of the game. And the other thing you do is enforce laws. And that's the fun story part, you know, because enforcing laws, the main story is like this. The sheriff has come to town, you know, so that citizens like us, we're just a group of citizens, can hold governments and companies to account. And in 2010, we did that in the UK, which was the beginning of a Europe-wide air pollution cleanup campaign. We sued the government and beat it in its own Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court of the UK ordered the government to clean up the air. Now, I had talked to the heads of all of the major environmental organizations in the UK in 2010 and asked them whether they wanted to join and be represented for free. And they all said, clean air isn't on our radar. That's not what we do. But by the time we won that case, there were thousands of newspaper articles about it. And that helped start this whole movement. There are now groups of parents all over the UK demanding clean air for their kids, demanding it from their schools, demanding it from their local authorities. And this has spread. We now have had cases in 20 countries in the EU, I think. We're winning all of them and getting similar results and getting citizens to realize that they can have a voice in demanding clean air. And just, you know, as we come out of the coronavirus, which was the theme you started at the beginning, what we need to do and all need to be creative about thinking about is how we come out of it in a better way and how we build resilient communities. Because this isn't the last crisis we're going to have. There'll be climate change.
We're going to come to that in a moment, but I think we've got a cliffhanger.
When I became an English lawyer, I learned that in the UK, one writes a very polite letter to someone before you sue them. So we wrote a very polite letter to the UK government. We said, the limits you have to meet are this. The timeline by which you have to meet it is 2010. It's now 2011. Surely you are going to do something about it. Oh no, they said. We have no intention whatever of complying with the law until at least 2025.
The government was essentially ignoring it, saying, meh, doesn't make economic sense.
We said, okay, see you in court.
I liked him because he was sort of mercurial and funny and made it almost sort of a game.
We went to the High Court, and the High Court judge said, I'm not going to do anything about it.
Frankly, I thought it was a bit shoddy, to tell you the truth.
We then went to the Court of Appeals, and the Court of Appeals judge said, roughly, this law is rather vague. I don't think there's anything to enforce. But I had picked the air quality law to enforce partly because it was the most precise law I could find.
It's not vague. The whole point of law is not to be vague. The point of law is for everyone to agree this is what we're talking about.
So we go to the Supreme Court. And in the Supreme Court, astoundingly, the UK government stands up and says, we're in violation of the law, can't deny it. But we have no intention whatsoever of complying with the law till at least 2025. And you, the Supreme Court, may not order us to do so. I practiced Zen for 35 years. It's very helpful. You know, the old samurai warriors practiced Zen so that they would be clear and present. It's as simple as this. So you breathe and you don't change how you breathe. And you just breathe, you count your breaths every time you breathe out. And you do that until you get to 10, and then you go back to 1. What we said, in essence, was forget that this is an environmental case. If the government can come in and say to the Supreme Court, we're only going to comply with the law when it suits us, then you're not living in a democracy under the rule of law. You're living under fiat and diktat of a government. And the Supreme Court, when we said it that way very nicely, said roughly, well, now that you put it that way, and they gave us an injunction. And the injunction was to the government, come into compliance, write a plan to come into compliance as soon as possible. The government did write a plan, but the plan was a very, very poor plan indeed. We went back to court, and we got the High Court to enforce the Supreme Court's injunction with a more detailed prescription of what the government had to do.
The Prime Minister, Theresa May, is to make a surprise announcement in the next 15 minutes.
I have just chaired a meeting of the Cabinet where we agreed that the government should call a general election.
And they said, oh no, we mayn't do it during the election because, among other things, everyone in the electorate would become so obsessed by our clean air plan that it would distract them from voting and really considering issues.
There was a lot of energy and commotion around outside. There were reporters and my colleagues had all these boxes that we were having to carry into the court. And it was quite packed.
the judge started off with a little speech, and it was obvious that this was a fellow who knew his onions.
The judge listened to the government's claims that it needed to delay taking care of the public health, and he rejected them vigorously.
So when do we get the final plan?
Let me consult my notes. I should know all these dates by heart by now. It was the 5th of May.
Part of the problem has been that people think the system is unreformable. You can't, there's nothing you can do with it. It's just this kind of machine that trundles on. Well, this says you can use the mechanisms that exist now and you can change the system.
Litigation is hand-to-hand combat. You know, it's really, it's nothing but war. If you're focused on the goal and you've got the law on your side and you've got the public behind you, which we now do, then you win.
James, you said that you identified a gap in the market when it came to the environmental cause, not enough lawyers. It's not a phrase you'll hear very often. What did you feel that the law could lend that wasn't actually happening at that time? And it was the pushback. I mean, did people feel this isn't for lawyers, this is for protesters, this is for people who are out on the streets?
To unmute James somehow.
We're fighting for the planet and people, which makes us a very different sort of group of lawyers, you know? And what we identified was that the very strong power that you have by going to court or by going to parliament and helping to write laws, can you still not? Is what was missing. So in the EU, there was a fantastic and really excellent ability to protest, to get the point across, but they didn't have that razor sharp ability to either write laws that would really work or to kill the dragons that needed to be killed. And that's what we were trying to supply.
Now, Jaime, you are coming up from the other direction in a way. You are one of those direct action people. You've been an active force with Extinction Rebellion. I wonder, just going back to the idea of Greta Thunberg inspiring people, whether there was one thing in particular that had motivated you and sort of pushed you into action.
I guess as a long tenant and a long lover and admirer of nature and planet Earth, I guess my journey into activism started in my early teens, where I just started to become more aware and having quite a natural anxiety rise due to the sort of state of the planet. Is that okay?
Yeah, don't worry. We're just trying to get a bit of excitement in there, a bit of kind of musical.
Sure.
I'm trying to make my son think I'm cool.
But I guess it was the growing knowledge and sort of growing panic in me as a teen that of the human mass consumption and the sort of slight information being fed to me about the mass use of fossil fuels and oil and the seriously damaging effects that it has to the planet. But
at what point did it become personal? At what point did it become, because, you know, we are all fed that information, you know, and we're quite passive with it, aren't we? And then suddenly there's...
Yeah, you kind of look in the information and you go, God, that's really terrible, but everything seems fine. But I think it, for me, was the turning point when I became a mother and you start thinking with a different head on your shoulders and about the future of the children and when we do leave this earth, what are we leaving for the next generation to deal with? And it just became very real. I'm sorry, I've lost you, Mariella.
Explain to our viewers that it's just a little sound problem that we're having and we're trying to sort out, but we're just going to babble on through.
But I guess essentially, you know, you want your child to thrive and also live a sustainable future and a happy future. So I then went on to work with, from quite a young age, I worked with Save the Wild Tigers to stop poaching and tackle the animal wildlife trade, which opened up so many more unhumane doors for me. And then eventually I ended up in the hands of XR, which was so rightly placed at the time. And I started working with them about a year ago fully during the protest, but really sort of trying to find where I sit and where my role is and how I could use my platform successfully without feeling like I'm just sort of jumping on a bandwagon.
Brilliant. Well, we'll talk a bit more about that in a moment. I wonder, Jerry, if I can come to you. And we will be talking about your wonderful film, How to Change the World, in a moment, and in fact, playing a clip from it. But I wondered first if you just indulge me and tell me when you first, you know, what first prompted you into the idea of using film as activism?
I guess I started using film in media and youth and community work, kind of working with people to tell their stories in a very kind of local way, used as an advocacy tool. And that was in the early 1980s, very different media environment in which there were maybe just 4 broadcast channels and no real means that people could make films about their own concerns. But I think what excited me was the power it had to kind of make a space in which people were listened to, you know, and I took that, I think, into my documentary filming making later.
Well, environmental activism has, of course, recently been played out in front of the media. Everything gets played out in front of the media now, which has helped gain, you know, enormous momentum. But it's not new, even though some people might think so. This modern activism, you know, with cameras in hands, first had an impact with the founders of Greenpeace, as shown in your documentary, How to Change the World. Let's see a clip from that wonderful film.
The Atomic Energy Commission now receives the requisite authority to go ahead, including detonation.
The protest ship, the Greenpeace, is heading for Amchitka, hoping to anchor offshore and stop the test.
There was definitely an unfinished feeling after Amchitka. Bob felt that there needed to be an ecology movement on the same scale as the civil rights movement, the women's movement, the peace movement.
Hunter said, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna save the whales.
Whales?
Whales? I thought he was just nuts.
Expecting any violence on the part of the whalers?
Bob coined the term mind bomb for what today we would call going viral, where an idea gets into the electronic media and just spreads like ripples on a water instantly.
Battle lines are drawn again between conservationists and government officials.
Harpooning a whale is not really a story, but people risking their lives to protect the lives of a whale, that's a story.
George Croft and Bob Hunter are in the Zodiac.
We have to get between the whale and the harpooner. That's the image we have to get.
Jerry, I love that term, mind bomb. I wondered if you could tell us a bit about why the almost crazy spirit of those early environmentalists proved so inspiring and how their use of media was so important to tell their story. And they really were pioneers in that way, weren't they?
Yeah, I mean, this was sort of late 60s, early 70s, and it was really the first time you could shoot some footage and network it out to global media within 24 hours. So you could shoot a short bit of 16 millimeter and it would reach the world's living rooms in a very short space of time. And Bob Hunter, who you saw in that clip, was this kind of very prescient journalist. He coined this term mind bomb, which for him was like trying to find an image which would encourage people to sort of rethink their assumptions. He saw, I guess he kind of saw campaigns as a sort of story in themselves. Like in the film somewhere, he says, you know, this is reality to the camera people. And then he goes, oh no, this is theater. He thinks of campaigns as kind of stories. And I guess the film is about those ideas, but also then the limitations of those ideas, you know, that yes, you can create these memes, but then you also need to get into strategy and tactics and interpersonal issues and kind of you know, keep a focused strategic campaign in the way James does.
But he was also, I mean, in many ways, he was a spin doctor, wasn't he? I mean, he was a cynical manipulator of the media for his purposes, you know, and you know, his purposes, you know, many of us believe were good. But I wondered how you think he would have reacted in today's media world, and how storytellers today can get their issues to the forefront. Is it very different, do you think, the landscape? Or easier?
I think it's much harder. I think, you know, we experience, I don't know what the statistic is, you know, as many images as in a day as probably someone in the 60s experienced in a lifetime or in a decade. You can't simply shoot a dramatic set of images and that pulls people's attention in. There's an enormous kind of vying for people's attention. But I guess what he saw was that those things could kind of encapsulate something much bigger. So for him, the whale campaign was about an image of a human being putting their lives at stake, you know, between a harpoon gun and a whale. That was the kind of thing they wanted to capture. But then that created a story. You know, here's a group of people who are, you know, in his words, putting their body where their mouths are and trying to capture that image. That's the story of the campaign, and that's the story that went out on the world's media, and ultimately resulted in the whaling moratorium in the 80s. I mean, that took a while to get to that, but certainly the spark of it was that little kind of 90-second bit of film footage that they captured.
And in fact, you know, despite the sort of onslaught of imagery that we're all subjected to these days, those single moments sort of envisaged by Bob Hunter do still have enormous impact. I'm thinking of that tiny child washed up on the beach of a Greek island, you know, which I think for many people really, really brought home what the refugee crisis actually meant in the cost of human life. You know, that there is still time and space for those moments of stillness.
Yeah, they do. I think, I mean, it's tricky because they can be as misleading as they can be kind of leading, can't they? I mean, they can tell something kind of absolutely true, sum up a moment, but at the same time, or they can be images which kind of create a fake outrage. And that's where I feel like part of our role of storytellers is how do we work with an audience to kind of build your kind of critical approach to all of this? How do we make an active audience, not one that we're telling what to do?
James, how about you? I mean, how do you think storytelling can be a vital element in achieving your objectives?
Well, it's absolutely vital. I mean, at every level. And I mean, for example, when you go to court, you're telling a story. You're telling a very particular type of story. Like a sonnet is a particular type of way of telling a story. You know, it's a very fixed way a set of rules, a sonnet, and appearing in court, you have to talk a certain way, which is
it's
very different.
It's a polemic, isn't it? Is it a polemic? Would it be fair?
Yes, it is a kind of polemic, yeah. And you have to, so each story really for each audience, you know, if you were talking in front of a stadium, you'd speak in a different way than you would to a judge. But winning a case is about knowing all the rules and then telling a better story. Absolutely about telling a better story. And then you need a story around it of the type that Jerry and Jaime help make, in that you need the public to be on your side. So in the clean air work, the public got riled, and that was very helpful. So there has to be a political story going on in context of which you bring a laser sharp legal case. Otherwise you could win a case but lose the war. So.
And how conscious do you have to be of creating the narrative around your case?
Oh, completely. No, you have to know the politics, the people, the economics, and then indeed you have to try and tell it in a really sympathetic way. I mean, the way we envisaged the clean air work at home was that it was the story of Amy's lungs. And Amy was an 8-year-old girl that we imagined whose lungs were being damaged by air pollution, because that's a demographic that really gets harmed by this. And then we told a story around Save the Children, because it's a truthful story. To Jerry's point, you know, you can lead or mislead. We always want the story to be completely aligned with the truth, but you want to open the truth up so that people can react to it.
That feels to me, Jaime, in a way, how in your work as an actress, you can also embrace the campaigning that you've been doing with Extinction Rebellion, because it's surely the making of those stories impactful to us as individuals, to make them have a universal sting, if you will, that prompts us into action is really important. Do you think that the dramas and the stories being told do reflect all of our interest in these causes now? Or do you think that there's a lot of work could be done to kind of, I remember in the 80s, you know, there was so many brilliant dramas about, you know, the anti-nuclear campaign, you know, from films like Silkwood to that brilliant series on the BBC, was it Edge of Darkness? You know, and there was all this great stuff that was actually fueled by campaigning zest.
Well, I think it's really important in these times, but I think it's also kind of, there's been such a negative flip as well with the British media and media in its sense of just trying to sort of scaremonger and ram these facts down people's necks. And that arises fear, and then that also then puts up an arrogant wall. So the point of storytelling and, you know, gathering stories and facts and putting them together and creating this, you know, huge wall of realness and facts. And I think that's the way we've got to target it, because, you know, I was faced with so many sort of different sort of conclusions with like being a mum and conflicted and sort of, how do I make these changes and not become a hypocrite in my own life, and how do I project that? And so that was my involvement with XR, really finding that role, my platform and my voice.
But there's a drama in there too, isn't there? I can see Jerry nodding. He may well write your story.
There's always a drama. I mean, you know, there was a kind of a woke moment I had one day in my kitchen and cooking my son his afternoon lunch, and you know, I had a knock on the door, and I opened the door, and there was this kind of, the only word I could really describe it was, he was quite shabby looking, and he put a dictaphone in my face and he said, you know, Jaime Winstone, you know, I'm from the Daily Mail, you got on a private jet this time, you know, 15 years ago, and you're doing all this stuff with XR. And I just had this moment of complete disbelief, although, you know, we are in a climate crisis, we are, you know, essentially now in a coronavirus crisis.
We do all change over a period of 15 years as well, which obviously there wasn't the room for there. James, Paul, over these last 2 days, there's been an online conference going on, I think it ends today maybe, co-hosted by the UK and Germany, with environment ministers from 30 countries joining to discuss how to organise a green economic recovery once the worst of the pandemic is over, which sounds like really good news. Do you think it's a sign that governments will finally put real effort into making economic stimulus sustainable and equitable?
Well, I really hope so. And the fact that they're talking about it is step one. I mean, what all of us are who follow these things are a little tired of is government saying beautiful things and then not quite getting around to doing it. But the fact that they're saying it is incredibly important, step one. And it's an amazing opportunity, because you have all of this stimulus money that has already been put out, but then there's a second huge wave. And that second huge wave of stimulus is probably the largest amount of money that governments are going to spend in decades. And if it's spent in the right way for green things, it could help save the world. If it's spent on brown things, the world goes the other direction. The good news is that things have changed dramatically. You're talking about the last 15 years. In the last 15 years, the renewable energy, for example, has become a beautiful thing, which is cheaper than coal. So if you wanted to build an energy system and you wanted to invest in it, you would make more money by building a solar system plus batteries than by simply running a coal plant. That means that governments should want to invest in this stuff. And there's a big study coming out of Oxford in the next few days with 250 economists from around the world. They've been looking at 70 different stimulus packages from 2008 onward. And what they are going to show very, very clearly is that the things that we all love actually are the right things to be investing in.
It's interesting that you mentioned the energy companies. You know, I'm sure you've had experience of some of the companies that will be less than opaque about their environmentally friendly policies, you know, and the energy companies are right up there in a way, despite what they promote. Tell me a little bit about your experience with BP. I think it's not the first time BP has exaggerated, and we've got this little clip in their archive. So maybe I can just play that in quickly first.
Sure. I wonder
if you can play the BP clip. Yeah.
Change up to BP Super. Change up to BP Super. It makes your car more willing. Gives more energy, gives more miles for every shilling. Change up to BP Super. BP Super.
That's what I call horse bar. And it's all yours when you change up to BP Super.
Change up to BP Super, it makes your car more willing. Gives more energy, gives more miles for every shilling. Change up to BP Super.
Super, duper.
BP Super.
Super, duper, terribly posh. Change up to BP Super. BP were actually successfully sued for talking up their green credentials, I think, James, weren't they? Do you think that companies will be more responsive now? I mean, several of them have made big statements of transformation towards a sustainable future. Equinor, from my native Norway, is one of them, with very large investments launched in offshore wind farms like Dogger Bank, I think.
Yes, well, and the Dogger Bank is a great example of energy company beginning to transition into doing the right thing. And this was a very good case of story, because we sued them for false advertising. All of their investments in renewable energy was everything they did. We're a renewable company. We're a renewable company. When you went to airports, back in the days when you went to airports a few months ago, there were these vast posters, and you saw them and you said, wow, they must be a renewable energy company. Well, they weren't. And we got angry and we sued them and we beat them. And they apologized and they said, we'll never lie again. Now, that's what you're asking about.
That's like my teenagers. Yeah, and then you see sort of graphics like the Equinor Dogger Bank project, which is just so vast. It's like,
yes.
It looks twice the size of Greater London, or at least as big as Greater London. I just wanted to go back to, you know, this idea of you know, change post-coronavirus. And of course, you know, one of the truly terrible things at the moment, aside from the fatalities, is the economic impact of what's happened and the terrible, terrible impact that's having on people's lives. Which of course will play into how they react to the demands that are going to be made after the lockdown ends. I wondered if I could ask you first, Jerry, how much Greenpeace you feel were the product of the time in which they operated, and whether they could have sprung to global attention at any other time, and whether there were similar circumstances.
I mean, I guess, Greenpeace sprang up in a very particular place, Vancouver, in the late 60s, where there was this collision of two things. One was the anti-Vietnam movement, many of whom were United States citizens who'd fled the draft and moved across the border into Vancouver. And the other was a city that was kind of also very much linked with the environment, close to vast forests, to the coastline, used to kind of working with boats. And so I think those were the sort of forces that made kind of Greenpeace what it was, you know, this organization that went out in boats to sort of initially resist nuclear testing. But it's interesting that it's kept that form. Well, you know, it's kept elements of that form for 20, 30 years, that idea of the sort of spectacular boat-based protest. And maybe there's a different kind of movement growing up in a different kind of city environment now.
Jaime, you definitely don't lead a limousine lifestyle. I wondered, you know, directly in your day-to-day life, how the lockdown and coronavirus has impacted on you, has affected your lifestyle.
Personally, it's affected me extremely dramatically. Essentially, my work has stopped. My schooling for my child has stopped, as most everybody. But in terms of moving back, I will have to move home. I will have to readdress my whole future plans. But in terms, you know, these are the things that we are faced in times like this, where you go, well, we were waiting for a change. We're waiting for something really dramatic to happen. And definitely know I was. And it comes in this shape and form, and you're punneled into shock. And, you know, I've been in a very lovely, privileged situation where I'm staying in a beautiful commune in Dorset right now. But we'll have to pack my things up and go back to reality, which is extremely harsh. There's no money coming in. There's no support unit. I've been told that my rent will be supported, but I will have to eventually pay it back, which means nothing. I'm setting up crowd funds with my family for the NHS, which I personally think we should be paying for anyway, because that should be covered. So my whole life scale has completely changed, as everybody's has. So I'm having to rethink different ways, but this is the time to change. And, you know, thinking about how we live our lives, this is the moment to do it. You know, this is the time to grab hold of it and try and find some sort of excitement in change, and finding new ways of staying creative and pushing forward in terms of lifespan and how we're going to survive. You know, it really is this conversation we've been having.
And James, what do you think specifically are the environmental issues that we're going to be facing and we need to be addressing as we come out of coronavirus?
Well, I mean, the two really big ones that we face as a global civilization are climate change and the loss of nature, you know, the loss of biodiversity. Those are the two biggest ones, and everything else kind of cascades down from there. There are many others, like clean air that we were talking about. But if we don't address issues of climate change, then this will really just be the first of many waves of difficulty we find ourselves in. And the great thing is that we actually do know what to do about that. So we need to change our energy systems, our transport systems, our agriculture, our manufacturing. We know about all those things. And the economics is now on our side. So even though there are old companies who want to burn coal, there are new companies who want to supply like Equinor with its wonderful wind farm, who want to supply clean energy. So the shift needs to be made, and that's the opportunity. So we're in this period of destruction of everything, as Jaime was just illustrating on a personal level, and it's very moving, and that's happening for a great many people. And then on a social level, the way we do things is also changing. So companies that make electricity with coal are going to be finding that over the next few months, they become uneconomic. That allows a shift to be made by politicians investing in the right thing. So we want to make sure we address climate change, and then we need to stop killing nature. Those two things.
Jerry, it seems like a simple question, but or simplistic question, but do all causes have good stories? So, in other words, as a filmmaker, do you go to the cause that you're interested in and find the story? Or do you find a story and then become perhaps animated about whatever it relates to?
I mean, I think stories have to be specific. They can't just be a kind of generic example of something you want to tell people. So kind of invariably the story is based in the person, in the people. What fascinated me about Greenpeace was there were this group of friends, 12 friends perhaps, who came together kind of out of a shared passion and a shared kind of courage, but then the sort of success that they had in their campaigning in some ways really destroyed or undermined their friendship. So there was a kind of tension there. And I think good stories have a, you know, they don't answer a question. They don't ask a question that you already know the answer to. I think as a filmmaker, you want to explore an important sort of question dilemma without necessarily knowing the answer, and you want to take the audience on that self same journey. So for me, those are the kinds of stories that are interesting to look at.
We've got a question here from one of our viewers, Enviro Loop, who's got a question for you, James. Do Client Earth use information and evidence collected by citizens to help build a case? Does that stretch to a video or image taken on a smartphone? I'm not quite sure why Enviro Loop's asking this question. Sounds a little bit suspicious to me.
Enviro Loop may have a great film. And Jerry or Extinction Rebellion may actually be, a better place to use that film, because we don't tend to base cases on such things. Although we always work with groups of citizens. So in Milan, Filthy Air, we work with the Mothers of Milan, and in Africa, when we work with on forestry, we work with groups of local citizens. And help them, people who depend on the forests. So we work with them intimately and defend their rights. So we do use lots of evidence from all sources. I haven't yet started a case based on a film someone has sent from a smartphone, but you never know.
There you go, Enviro Loop. Jerry, is it easier now to make campaigning films, do you think? I mean, there were very few platforms for them when you started out as a filmmaker. And of course, now there's a plethora, you know, from Netflix to Amazon to, you know, getting them onto YouTube. Has that made it easier? Or do you think that in a way, you know, in the deluge, it's harder for us to find what we relate to and harder for filmmakers to find their audience?
I mean, I think the tools of making it are much more accessible, and as you know, as the last questioner said, you know, that fact that we all have in our pockets, you know, the tools to document things that are happening, we're all kind of in a way the eyes of nature. We can use that power. So it's easier to make films, maybe, but at the same time, there is just this enormous kind of wealth of media to vying for attention to vying for people's attention, and so in that sense, I think it's really hard to make a film rise above that and capture people's interest.
It's interesting, Jamie, isn't it? Because your film Protesting is really, you know, feet on the ground, hands on. In many ways, it's very old fashioned, to some extent, I suppose, doesn't employ all the various forms of storytelling that are now available to all of us to use, you know, whether it's for the law in James's case, whether it's for filmmaking in Jerry's. How do you feel about that? Do you feel that protest is something that needs to be very tangible, and that the best stories come out of that absolute direct hands-on connection with it?
I think it's for me, it's been a real personal journey, but coming together with all these people, not knowing necessarily where they sit in society because of, you know, it was very sort of secluded. You either, you know, believe in climate crisis or you don't. You think it's just, you know, it's a load of nonsense, where it was actually that sort of urgency of getting it out there and getting people to wake up and just realizing that this, you know, to tell the truth and for just to beg governments just to, you know, stop sort of putting people into this kind of protestic, chaotic and, you know, anarchy sort of slot because they're protesting for their planet. For me, it was about joining the team that are going in the right direction for the future. I'm not sure about how that would story tell, but I'm pretty sure the people that I met and was inspired by made more sense than anybody has ever made more sense to me for watching news or explaining it to me, or even just simply having a lesson on the climate crisis itself. You know, that for me, it was a personal journey, and I feel like, you know, we all just have to fast track our existential status in that sense, because what we're facing is really happening. And I think it's really important for us all just to come together and share these, hence these talks like this, how we move forward creatively and without sort of relying on governments or relying on essentially lies, or a load of people that don't really know what they're talking about. You know, I don't want to get angry, but you know,
we're all angry one way or the other.
We're pretty angry and on edge, and it's just kind of like we need, you know, we do need to come together and face this all together. And you know, one of the saddest things at the moment is none of us can really touch or, you know, get back to basics and how humans work in the first place.
Well, all the more reason for storytelling, I suppose, to take precedence. I was interested, you just said, you know, people lying to us and so on. And of course, you know, the real demon out of coronavirus at the moment, you know, appears to be China. And, you know, there's a billion conspiracy theories about, you know, virus eruption and so on. But more seriously, James, I was quite interested in what you said, because, you know, China do very much are very much seen as the sort of baddie of the moment. But I read in the clippings that I was reading about you that your experience there has been a pretty positive one. And in fact, in many ways, their attitude to the environment and to climate change is more positive in terms of their determination to battle it than our own government here.
Well, yes. And I mean, talk about a story that doesn't get out. I mean, what we see in the West is a very negative portrayal of China. And you know, it's not that the things that are portrayed are wrong. I mean, there's a lot that is not very agreeable about China these days. But the thing that is missed is, just as you're saying, they really care about the environment. And they care about it in the way that everybody should, which is out of enlightened self-interest. You know, we take care of the environment, we're happier. Now, I was called in 2014 by a group of Supreme Court judges who were writing a law to allow citizen groups to sue companies that were polluters, including companies owned by the state government. Amazing, you know, really amazing. So I went there as an expert and helped them write that law. And then that turned into training judges. So they really wanted to bring a lot of cases or have a lot of cases brought so that polluting companies were required to obey the law, which they weren't doing. So they put together a group of 3,000 environment court judges. Remarkable. So we started training judges. We've trained over 1,000 of them now. And then the federal prosecutors came to us and said, in that law you helped write, we got the ability to sue the central government for the first time and to sue them on behalf of the people if they're not enforcing the law. But we have never sued the government. You sue governments all the time and you always seem to beat them. Could you train us to sue the Chinese government? And I thought, wow, this is really like a science fiction moment I've stepped in, you know? And I said, well, of course. So we've trained the prosecutors now for several years. And in the last 2 years, they've brought over 100,000 cases. Against a lot against companies, but the majority of them are against local governments, authorities who aren't enforcing the law. It's amazing.
I mean, Jerry, the thing you can't really argue, I suppose, is that you need good characters to tell a story and to make a film. You know, you had that with your Greenpeace film. You know, you think of films like Erin Brockovich. You know, where I mean, obviously not a documentary, but which very much brings alive the cause she was fighting through the sort of sheer force of the personality that it's carried by. I wonder what the stories are that you're looking at now in terms of telling, and whether, how do you find them? Do you look for the characters? Do you find a little nugget and explore it further? Do you have to be constantly scanning? How do you do it?
I mean, it feels to me that the sort of there's kind of tons of stories out there, but it's like, what's the one that you're gonna spend time with is an important one, important story for now, you know. So finding people who face dilemmas that you think are kind of urgent dilemmas for all of us now. So at the moment, I'm just at the beginning process of making a film about a Sierra Leonean lawyer who trying to work with people around land rights in discussions when actually to Chinese or British companies even come in and use their resources or lease land for their resources. And in that case, you know, there's someone at the center of it who is a kind of strong character, but it's also a story that from that you can go out to these kind of layers, some of which happen in global boardrooms and some of them happen in a village discussion. To get that kind of breadth, I think, is really important.
Well, we have another question from a viewer from Georgia, Elliot Smith, who's asking, and it's a question for all three of you, so I will come to all three of you on this, what you think are the unexplored topics of the moment. Maybe I'll start with you, James.
I was hoping you were going to start with me third, but the unexplored topics of the moment. What a wonderful question. This is clearly a group of creative people we have watching. Unexplored questions, the one that isn't talked about very much in media anyway, is what Jaime was getting at, but it's how does an individual wake up to these issues? How does an individual person change their lives, embracing a new way of thinking? So if we're gonna have an ecological civilization, how does an individual wake up? And that's what many of us experience individually, but I'm not sure it's being explored in the media.
Jaime? Or has James stolen yours?
Oh, sorry if I have.
No, but a little bit. I could just extend on that. I'm so glad you did, James. You're my hero. But it's more about how spiritually and how mentally we're going to deal with this, and also the areas of mental health that are just completely sort of being put back to the end of the pile again. How we can sort of embrace this in society and not close up in panic and fear and sort of address it as a wide scale mental health problem, because it's going to affect us all in such a dramatic way. So it would be good to sort of have a more open discussion, whether it just being about mental health and NHS or this and that. It's actually a really important part for all of us to sort of to appreciate, the mental health of us all and support that. So I wouldn't know how to go into that, but yeah, that's what I would like to explore more.
Especially after lockdown, I can tell you.
Jerry,
what about you? Unexplored topics. I know you don't want to give away your next film.
I think the stories that are hard to tell but are important to tell are ones which somehow get at the systemic. It feels that the problems that we face at the moment are so embedded in the systems we live within, so to every kind of, the economy, and then to every kind of cog within that economy and its priorities. That's the sort of ship we have to turn around to face climate change. And that's quite a hard thing to do in a story, because stories are mostly about individuals kind of battling perhaps their own desires or kind of pursuing a personal objective. So it's how do you kind of fuse those two things? How do you kind of unite the kind of individual and the systemic, but not see this as simply an individual problem? It's somehow we have to grapple with the systemic issues, and that involves economists and governments and politicians and laws.
We have another question, and it may be coming to our close. So if you've got any questions out there, send them in right now, because otherwise we're not going to be here for you to get answers. This one is from Tad Kirakowski. I hope I'm pronouncing that right, Tad. Who says, across the protesting, film or litigation, what ways can we get our story out to those who aren't yet engaged with climate or environment actions? A really good question, this. Or how do we reach outside our bubbles is the basic nub of it. James?
Yes, well, I think what often isn't done enough, and XR was certainly working on this, and Greta is working on this, when it comes to environment and climate, is connecting up these very large issues that Jerry was mentioning, these big structural issues, with how they affect individual lives. So, I'm not interested in climate change itself. I'm interested in people, so how do we protect people? How do we take care of people? And the way we take care of people is by stopping climate change. So to me, and it's not always easy, because the issues can be very abstract. So I was talking about energy systems a while ago, and gets very abstract. But what you want is to make sure that the people in Tuvalu aren't washed away, and they're very real people, and so on. So how to connect it with human life in a very intimate way, I think, the big issues with human life.
And I guess, Jaime, Extinction Rebellion, you're already out of the bubble, with that crew. Yeah, right. Yeah, the whole system's kind of changed in how people work and come together. But for me, it would be addressing people's cultures, you know, and really appealing to people's cultures and sort of lifting the lid on this is only affecting certain pockets of the world, which people are still blissfully really unaware of. You know, addressing people's cultures and integrating what can be done and how positive changes can be made in certain different cultures and different races, really.
And Jerry, I mean, we're always accused, those of us in the sort of media and the film business and so on, that we are all living in a bubble. How do we step out of there and engage with the world and bring in new people?
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, it's sort of really important that the films don't just play to the choir, you know, play to an audience that's already invested in those issues. And I think that by doing that, you need to, I think it's similar to what James said, really, you know, you need to connect them to just the basic kind of human needs and demands, to love, fulfillment, survival, security, those things that we all need. Those are present in the Greenpeace story and the group of people who are sort of jumping into a boat to kind of get in the way of a harpoon gun, just as they are. And those are kind of relevant to everyone, not just to the whaling issue or the climate issue.
Absolutely. Well, I think that just about wraps it up for today. We've really enjoyed talking to all three of you. Thank you so much. You've been incredibly inspiring. Thank you to my guests, James Thornton, Jerry Rothwell, and Jaime Winstone. Their stories have hopefully been an inspiration to all of you out there. And if so, and you have a campaigning film idea, why not pitch it to Met Film? We'll give you £1,000 production funding if you're successful with your pitch. But now it's just time for me to say thank you very much to everyone. I know Jamie's dying to get off to her four-year-old before her four-year-old invades the sitting room.
Very lucky.
And our webinar. I've really enjoyed hosting this webinar. Thank you very much to everyone who's made it possible, and of course, especially our guest today. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.